Everyone, and welcome to the seventh meeting of the sixth session of the Scottish Parliament's Citizen Participation and Public Petitions Committee. And this morning we have two items. We're going to be considering some continued petitions and subsequently consideration of some new petitions. The first petition we're considering this morning is a petition of long standing, petition number 1662, the improved treatment for patients with Lyme disease and associated tick-borne diseases. This was lodged by Janie Cringin and Lorraine Murray on behalf of Tick-Borne Illness Campaign Scotland. And the petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to improve testing and treatment for Lyme disease and associated tick-borne diseases by ensuring that medical professionals in Scotland are fully equipped to deal with the complexity of tick-borne infections. When this was last considered in September, we agreed to seek an update from the Scottish Government regarding the outcome of the roundtable event that was due to be held to bring together clinicians, patient representatives and public health experts to discuss testing, treatment and raising awareness. To discuss any progress that had been made in establishing an infectious diseases managed clinical network, and also to the steps that were being taken by the Scottish Government to encourage research into Lyme disease. In its submission, the Scottish Government confirmed that two roundtable events have now taken place, and as a result of these, two subgroups have been set up to look at raising public awareness and the education of healthcare professionals. Both groups have now met in recent weeks, and work to establish an infectious diseases managed clinical network has been delayed due to the COVID-19 pandemic. In terms of research, the Scottish Government has agreed that it will work with the Scottish Lyme Disease and Tick-Borne Infections Laboratory at Raigmore Hospital, and they'll consider potential improvements to testing methods and processes. Now, the petitioners, meanwhile, suggest that from their perspective, the meetings held have so far been promising, but more is needed. Whilst they were involved in the roundtable events and the public awareness subgroup, they are not represented in the education of health professionals subgroup. They stress that a key aim of their petition is to improve treatment for those who are chronically ill with Lyme disease and other tick-borne diseases, and suggest that ensuring healthcare professionals receive adequate training to help them recognise and treat such conditions is crucial. They make a number of suggestions for suitable training resources. They also suggest that the establishment of an infectious diseases managed clinical network is not a suitable alternative to creating specialist treatment centres. The petitioners also note that whilst there has been progress in a number of areas, there are certain elements of their petition which the petitioners feel have not been addressed. And I just mention in passing the interest in this petition over time from our colleague Alexander Burnett, who held a members' business debate on it. It does seem to me, though, colleagues, that a considerable amount has now been achieved. And David Torrance, if I could maybe ask you just to remind us newbies of the work that was undertaken in what is a long-standing petition in the last session.
Thank you, Convener. The petition's been going some time. There's been a lot of work done in the last session. There's a lot of evidence taken. And as you said, there's been questions asked. And there's also been a members' debate. I think the Scottish Government has heeded what a petition is asking for, and there's a lot of progress being made in what a petitioner is wanting. So I would quite happily close the petition under Standing Rule 15.7, but in doing so, I would ask that we write to the Scottish Government so we could continue to engage with the petitioner.
Yep, I'm content with that. I mean, I think we can see that the establishment of the Educational Health Professional Subgroup, the Public Awareness Group, and the commitment to establishing the clinical network are all positive actions. Does anybody else wish to come in? Alexander Stewart.
Thank you, Convener. Yes, I think that there has been an enormous amount of work done on this over the last few years, and we have come a real journey. And I commend everyone who's been actively involved. I think, you know, the champions and the education side of things, and ensuring that general practitioners and the profession are much more informed, I think is vitally important. So I would be concurring with David Torrance that I think we've done enough at this stage, but there may be opportunities for you to clarify things in the future. But I think, as we've seen and heard, a lot has been done and a lot has been achieved so far in this whole process.
Colleagues, are we content to close the petition on that basis? Yeah, well, can I thank the petitioners for their contribution over a sustained period of time? I think considerable progress has been made, and I think they can take a lot of congratulation and satisfaction from the fact that that is the case. And as David Torrance suggested, we will encourage the Scottish Government to continue to engage as the various projects progress. Our second petition is PE 1804, Halt Highlands and Islands Limited's Air Traffic Management Strategy, which has been lodged by Alexander McEachin, John Doig and Peter Henderson on behalf of the Bendecula Community Council. The petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to halt Highlands and Islands Airport Limited's Air Traffic Management Strategic Project to conduct an independent assessment of the decisions and decision-making process on the ATM project. And I'm pleased to welcome both Liam MacArthur, who I note, because I recalled vividly, asked questions on this in, well, he made an intervention in a debate, and I actually thought it was an FMQ, but it turns out it was at a members' business debate that intervened on it. So welcome to you. And to Rhoda Grant, who I think is an unofficial member of this committee. I've remarked before that you seem to have a season ticket for our proceedings, but it's a testament to the strength of the petitions that we are considering from the Highlands and Islands region in this committee. But both delighted to have you here. Before I invite you to speak, I'll provide a brief summary of what has happened since we last considered the petition. At that last consideration, we agreed to write to the Cabinet Secretary for Net Zero Energy and Transport, the Civil Aviation Authority, the Scottish Government's Digital Assurance Office, and the Prospect Trade Union. We were seeking information from the Cabinet Secretary about the current status of the project, whether it was still on budget, and when a decision from the Civil Aviation Authority on the issue of automatic dependent surveillance broadcast was to be expected. We asked about an update from Prospect Trade Union about recent talks with Highlands and Islands Airports Limited, information from the Civil Aviation Authority regarding where remote tower technology had been successfully deployed. This was this assertion, as I recall, that, you know, there were examples all around the world and I wanted to know where they were. And information from the Scottish Government about action taken following the assurance health check carried out in January 2021. And an assurance that the project was complying with Scottish Government requirements for a project of this nature. And I'm pleased to say we have received responses to all our correspondence. A summary of these has been provided for members with this week's reports, papers. And the petitioner has also provided a further submission, which members should have in front of them now. And therefore, I will invite Rhoda and Liam to comment and contribute. Rhoda, would you like to go first?
Yes, thank you. Thank you, Convener. If the committee will indulge me a little, I've spoken to the petitioner and I have some information that I'd like to relay. As you said, High Island Prospect recently released a joint statement saying they'd agreed a framework for discussion regarding the new way forward for ATMS. Some people have taken this to mean that air traffic staff will now remain locally. However, this is not the case. Work in the remote towers is continuing and only the timetable has changed. It's widely believed that HIAL are not looking for a meaningful solution that does not involve remote towers. I understand from the petitioners that HIAL have hit some problems predicted in the evidence that they submitted to this committee, and that's why they've agreed to a delay. HIAL have stated that they will review air traffic provision after they have implemented the surveillance programme, and that is commonly referred to as radar. My understanding that the ATMS timetable has effectively been put on hold by HIAL for 5 years while they develop surveillance, which is required regardless of whether or not they proceed with remote towers. They have, however, said they will implement remote towers in Inverness, and this makes no sense except that they have already bought the building where this will be located, and it has no support from staff or indeed the public. Neither have remote towers been rolled out for any of the other airports. They're merely being postponed for up to 5 years by HIAL in the hope that the problems that are dogging the project at the moment will be resolved. And there is a concern, obviously, that delays will add to costs. The CAA currently require both primary and secondary radar. Primary radar shows an aircraft flying in the vicinity as a blip on the screen, but secondary requires equipment to be carried on an aircraft to identify it to the controller. And HIAL want to use this form of radar that shows suitably equipped aircraft. And this is an issue in some of those airports where there are flight clubs and light aircraft using airports quite often. In evidence to the committee, the Transport Minister said HIAL have had many discussions with the CAA around the direction of travel towards a more cooperative surveillance approach, which ADSB is one element of such a system. The CAA has not, however, given HIAL a firm time line for implementation. The CAA require HIAL to install primary radar. Primary radar could cost in excess of £30 million to implement, and that's not been budgeted for. Benbecula and Wick, John O'Groats airports, are also being treated separately. HIAL want to downgrade these airports from air traffic control to a flight information service, and the impact on the community served by Benbecula will be profound, and both Wick and Benbecula may have difficulty in finding airlines to operate PSO routes. Downgrading will also decrease safety, and that's unacceptable to the petitioners, air traffic staff and communities that serve those airports. It could result in less safe, less flexible operation and may lead to airborne conflict, putting passengers at risk. And this is especially an issue in Benbecula, which is very close to the kinetic range. And it would also prevent Wick from becoming a hub for offshore traffic, as it did quite recently in the past. At the moment, work is ongoing to try and attract more flights rather than fewer to both those airports. It will also cause unnecessary delays and cancellations to aircraft using those airports in bad weather during the winter. One of the petitioners told me, and I'm just going to quote him, he says, in short, ATMS has been a mess since conception. It is continuing in the same way. The wheels are coming off HIAL's ATMS juggernaut, yet it rolls on, leaving damage in its wake. Needs to be steered into the scrapyard of history and left there. HIAL, as an organisation, must get a blank sheet of paper, sit down with representatives of the communities it is meant to serve, and redesign itself. The board and senior management have completely lost sight of their role, which is to run airports effectively for the benefit of their communities, not squander taxpayers' money unnecessarily on vanity projects. I couldn't agree more. Can I suggest that in the short term, the committee might contact HIAL and get a clear indication of their plans regarding surveillance and remote towers and whether they will recoup or lose funds if they dispose of the buildings that they have already purchased to house remote towers in Inverness, and perhaps in the long term keep a watching brief on this petition, because I fear that these developments are designed to take the heat out of the situation and make no real change to the direction of travel in the future.
Thank you very much, and we note that suggestion. Liam MacArthur.
I mean, thank you very much, Convener, firstly, for allowing me to participate in these discussions. I haven't got a great deal to add to what Rhoda Grant's just set out, which was pretty comprehensive, and I would agree with in its entirety. I think the five-year delay was almost inevitable anyway. I think that the deadlines that HIAL were working to were always heroically overambitious, and therefore we would have been at this point at some stage into the future anyway, alongside, I think, as Rhoda has touched on, an inflated budget, given the problems that the project's already hit. I recognise that from the perspective of the Petitions Committee, building in that five-year hiatus makes it difficult to pursue lines of inquiry, because the response back you will get is that all of this is under consideration and we will take a view in 4 to 5 years' time. But I think given the investments that HIAL are making in terms of remote tower in Inverness, given the, I suppose, the reputational investment the senior management have put into remote towers, the fact that they aren't really talking about alternatives to the remote tower model, I think just reinforces the impression that they've bought themselves a little bit of time, they've bought themselves some breathing space from the criticism they were receiving from across political parties, more importantly across the communities most directly affected, and therefore I would hope that there is some mechanism whereby the Petitions Committee can make clear that this remains in the crosshairs in terms of scrutiny, however that pans out over the next few months and years.
Okay, thank you both very much. Colleagues, does anybody want to respond to that? I mean, I am minded to keep the petition open if the committee is so minded. There was a specific request or suggestion from Rhoda Grant that we contact HIAL to get a clear idea of their plan, including the buildings already purchased and, you know, what the financial position is in relation to the potential loss of money in relation to that. Anybody else? Paul Sweeney.
The only other thing that sprung to mind was, the only other thing that sprung to mind was perhaps seeking submissions from the operators at the airport. So Logan Air, for example. I don't know if there's other airlines or other aviation users of the airports that might be worth feeding in to get their understanding of what the situation is and what their concerns are as well, as well as the Scottish Government and HIAL and the trade union.
Have we done that previously, or is that not aware of? Yeah, thank you. Yeah, then, since we haven't done that, I think that's a sensible suggestion. Anybody else? Got suggestions from our guests as well. Rhoda Grant.
Just on the back of that, I mentioned flight clubs and people using recreational aircraft. It might be worth trying to contact some of them to see what their concerns are. I know initially when this was first mooted, there was real concerns about how the airspace would be managed and how that would impact on their activities. I know there is, I think, a flying club based at Inverness, but there'll be other such organisations based throughout.
We'll seek to try and investigate that. Lee MacArthur.
I was going to say, in terms of the correspondence with HIAL, I think what it would be helpful to tease out is what alternative options they are actively considering. Because in a sense, what they've been able to talk about is the delaying of a final decision on remote towers. But if
without any alternative, no potentially, in the event that delay leads to be permanent.
Absolutely.
Yeah, fair enough. Yeah, that seems sensible. Are we happy with all of that?
Yes.
We are. Thank you both very much. Next petition is petition number 1837 to provide clear direction and investment for autism support, which colleagues may remember we took evidence on which we took evidence, apologies, at our last meeting. This was lodged by Stephen Layton. The petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to clarify how autistic people who do not have a learning disability and or mental disorder can access support and allocate investment for autism support teams in every local authority or health and social care partnership in Scotland. The petition was last considered by us, as I said a moment ago, on the 6th of October, when we took evidence from Kevin Stewart, the Minister for Mental Health and Wellbeing and Social Care, Hugh McAloon, Deputy Director for Children and Young People's Mental Health, and Jacqueline Campbell, Unit Head of the Children and Young People's Community Mental Health Scottish Government. The evidence session highlighted a number of key themes, including learning disability and autism and legislation, access to support services, user-centred services and good practice, and funding. At the session, the Minister stated that the Scottish Government is committed to establishing a Learning Disability, Autism and Neurodiversity Bill and to creating a commissioner to uphold and protect the rights of autistic people and others with neurodevelopmental difference. The committee also heard that support available to people with autism varied significantly across Scotland. That was quite marked, and could be particularly scarce for those who did not also have a learning disability or mental disorder, which is actually at the heart of the petitioner's concern. This increased the risk that people who could be turned away from services, leaving that person with no alternative route for support. The Minister recognised the need to ascertain what is going on out there that is right and what is not going so well, as he put it, emphasising the importance of people with autism influencing decision making. And the Minister highlighted a number of recent funding announcements relevant to the petition. It was a very informative evidence session. I wonder if colleagues would like to contribute a comment. Bill Kidd.
Yes, thanks very much, Convener. Just to emphasise, because being aware that the petition was speaking about people, particularly those with autism, but who didn't have a disability as such, the fact that the Scottish Government has actually stated already it's going to be publishing, or it is publishing, a Learning Disability, Autism and Neurodiversity Bill to create a commissioner role which will look into the range of autistic circumstance. And I think that actually pretty well covers what was being petitioned about.
Thank you. Paul Sweeney?
Can I'm minded, though it's encouraging that the government's response has indicated the forthcoming legislation, I think it is important, though, to give the petitioner some degree of assurance that the specifics of the legislation will address the concerns outlined in the petition, and perhaps also offer some degree of assurance about more immediate measures that could be put in place. I think in terms of just satisfying the petitioner's concerns, perhaps a more specific response from the government would be helpful, from the minister certainly would be helpful.
Yeah, I think that's a very fair request. Alexander Stewart?
Yeah, Convener, I would agree very much with Paul Smith's comments there. I think, you know, we very much found that there was a postcode lottery in the situation across councils and across areas of Scotland. And I think that would give us much more emphasis as to what might be the case when we're putting towards this bill, because there will be repercussions across many of those areas as to what can be achieved in the short and medium term. So I think that would be very useful.
You agree as well?
I absolutely agree.
I wasn't sure if you were going to make the same point or a different one, but you're content.
No,
So I think we're basically saying we'd write to the Minister for Mental Wellbeing and Social Care to ask how the Scottish Government will address the specific concerns that were raised within the petitioner's request, both on the short term and in the context of that forthcoming legislation. And then I think also to write to the Minister for Mental Wellbeing and Social Care to ask how he intends to collect and disseminate examples of good practice of services available. We agree with all of that. Okay, thank you very much. Regulation of Statutory Child Advocacy Services, petition number 1838, is continued, having been lodged by Martin Baker and Catherine Bailey. And this petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to ensure that non-statutory child advocacy services are properly regulated to ensure competence, transparency and accountability. We are expecting, hopefully, to be joined by Christine Graham, who is going to be speaking to us in relation to this petition. But before we potentially hear from Christine, if she's with us, some background information. When we last considered the petition in September, the committee decided to write to the Minister of Community Safety to ask whether she would undertake the work necessary to introduce legislation to regulate non-statutory child advocacy services. In response, the Minister stated that she is not in a position at this stage to commit to a consultation on such regulation. She highlighted that were this to be considered, there would be a number of issues to take into account, including enforcement, ensuring independence of child advocacy services and costs. The Minister also draws the committee's attention to a new section which is soon to be added to the Children's Scotland Act 1995, and this provides that Scottish ministers must make such provision to ensure that all children concerned in proceedings in which the court is considering making an order under Section 11 of the 1995 Act on matters such as child contact and residence have access to appropriate child advocacy services. The intention is to undertake a full public consultation with impact assessments in 2023. In their most recent submission, the petitioners state that they are dismayed, quote, they are dismayed at the apparent lack of urgency in the matter, noting in particular their disappointment that consultation is being proposed to begin in 2023. The petitioners reiterate their view that advocacy workers are intervening in children's lives and influencing his or her view of its own family life without transparency or accountability. Well, we had hoped to have Christine Graham with us, but not at the moment. So can I ask colleagues whether they have any views they would like to express? David Torrance.
Thank you, Convener. I know it's not what the petitioners want to hear, but the Scottish Government is committed to taking that review in 2023 and creating that new Section 100A under the Children's Scotland Act, which puts an emphasis on Scottish ministers to look into it. And from a response from the Minister for Community Safety, they're not willing to go to consultation, so I'm quite happy to close it under Rule 15.7 of Standing Orders. And if the petitioner's not happy with the outcomes in 2023, to bring a fresh petition back.
Colleagues, anybody else wish to express a view? Okay, I think, are we minded to accept David Torrance's proposal, it does seem to me that there is to be a consultation. I'm sorry we can't hear from Christine this morning, but and I understand the petitioner's disappointment at the timeline, but that is obviously now the intention of the Scottish Government to proceed on that basis, which will address the concerns raised by the petitioner. And I think on that basis, we would close the petition. Thank you. Petition number 1854, which is to review the adult disability payment eligibility criteria for people with motability needs. A continuing petition lodged by Keith Park on behalf of MS Society. And the petition calls on Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to remove the 20-metre rule from the proposed adult disability payment eligibility criteria or identify an alternative form of support for people with motability needs. At its last consideration in September, the committee agreed to write to the Department for Work and Pensions and the Scottish Government. I think specifically we wanted to seek clarity on the issue of delivering adult disability payments on what was, in inverted commas, a like-for-like basis with personal independence payments. In his response, the Minister for Social Security and Local Government acknowledges that respondents to a recent Scottish Government consultation on adult disability payment raised a number of key concerns, including that existing eligibility and payments should be protected with the introduction of any new benefit, that benefit recipients should not have to reapply for benefits in order to maintain their current entitlements, and that the existing eligibility criteria in relation to mobility does not adequately reflect the impact of certain disabilities and health conditions, with many responses focusing specifically on the 20-metre rule. The Minister states that an agreement has been met with the DWP, Department of Work and Pensions, that passporting to reserve benefits for adult disability payment clients will be assured in the immediate term. However, the Minister notes that any significant change to the eligibility criteria for adult disability payments could risk undermining this agreement. The DWP response provides an example of when receipt of enhanced devolved benefits can result in an additional payment from a reserve benefit. However, the petitioner states that the example provided by the DWP supports the position that an enhanced rate of motability payment does not entitle an individual to any additional reserve benefits and therefore would not be negatively impacted by a change to the eligibility criteria for the adult disability payment. The petitioner requests that the petition is kept open to allow stakeholders and the committee to examine the Scottish Government's response to the adult disability payment consultation, as well as take evidence from stakeholders. Colleagues, it was quite a long summation, but I do recall our discussion, I'm sure we all do, of this 20-metre rule and our writing to the various parties in relation to it. Would anybody like to contribute? Bill Kidd.
Yes, thank you very much, Convener. Personally, I've known people who have gone through this whole process. I believe that the 20-metre rule is a degrading and inhumane approach, in particular when it is repeated on more than one occasion, and I think it's something which really should not be there in the first place. I'd be perfectly happy if we continued this petition to look for further routes to try and achieve elements which are being looked for in the petition.
Thank you very much. Paul Sweeney.
Thank you, Convener. I agree with my colleague Bill Kidd about this. I think the principle, I think, has broad agreement across the Parliament, and the desire, I think, is there. It's a question of legality and potential unintended consequences that might affect DWP qualification. I think this is an area, a grey area, that needs to be dealt with sooner rather than later. We need to firm up the devolution of Social Security and how the interactions perform between the DWP and Social Security Scotland. This petition presents an extremely opportune way of doing that, I think. And with that in mind, I think inviting further submissions from MS Society, as well as Citizens Advice Scotland, the Alliance, perhaps also the Neurological Alliance of Scotland and Parkinson's UK, just to, as an indication of people who've already made submissions to the petition in the first instance or indicated support for the petition, would be helpful. And I think really there is a need for us to chip away at getting this thing sorted out, because it's clearly a technical issue. But given the you know, the severe harm that's potentially caused but to people. You know, I think getting it done sooner rather than later is helpful, and maybe deferring it. I think we should try and get it designed and fixed quicker than perhaps would otherwise happen.
All right, thank you very much. David Torrens?
Well, I just agree with my colleagues. I think we should keep the petition open and seek our advice from stakeholders.
Alexander Stewart?
I would agree, Convener. I think we need to continue seeking advice and finding out exactly. These organisations have a strong commitment and have already given some strong views, but it's vitally important that we get the stakeholders and those who are actually having to progress through this. So I think continuing it and taking further evidence will enhance our opportunity to try and find some solution to it.
Okay. Well, thank you. I think we are agreed that we will keep this petition open and that we will seek the views of the various bodies that were referred to there and also the views of some of our original submission contributors to the submissions we subsequently received from the Scottish Government and the DWP. We agreed? Great, thank you. Our next petition is petition 1857, regulate the role of the curator ad litem. I do apologise, last time my O-level Latin, I couldn't remember if it was litem or litem, but I'm now, despite that transgression after 50 years, I'm told it is litem. The next, and this is lodged also by Stephen Layton, whose petition on another matter we considered a few moments ago. This petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to regulate the curator ad litem and ensure historical claims of malpractice of curators ad litem in Scotland are investigated. At its last consideration, the committee agreed to write to key stakeholders seeking views on the action called for in the petition. In its submission, the Scottish Mental Welfare Commission states that curators ad litem are bound by the regulations of their respective professions. Usually this role is held by solicitors and less commonly by social workers. The Scottish Legal Complaints Committee states that it has no specific role in the regulation of or in dealing with complaints regarding curators ad litem. However, it may have a role if a complaint is made that a solicitor acting as a curator ad litem has breached certain standards of service or conduct which apply to solicitors. The SLCC responded to a recent consultation which included proposals for a new register of curators ad litem and a regulatory complaints regime. The Commission suggested that while a dedicated complaints process might be positive, it could potentially result in parallel investigations on the same matter, with different decisions, outcomes and sanctions being made against a practitioner. And finally, the Scottish Social Services Council suggests that requiring all curators ad litem to register with the SSSC would result in dual registration, as the majority of curators are solicitors who are already registered with the Law Society of Scotland. Quite complicated technical legal ease. Any thoughts from colleagues? David Torrens.
Thank you, Convener. When you see submissions from all the people involved, like the Scottish Legal Complaints Commission, they are not very supportive of a petition, but what I would say to a petitioner is there will be a review in of mental well-being and social care in, is it 2023? I might stand corrected. If they're not happy with the outcome of that, they can bring a petition back. So I'm quite happy to close a petition under Rule 15.7 of Standing Orders.
Thoughts of colleagues? Are we agreed? Yep. So I think the fact that there is a regulatory regime anticipated to be operational by 2023, I think allows us to close the petition at this point. But obviously just to keep an eye on how all of that progresses. And if it falls short, then encourage the petitioner to come back to us with another petition at that time. Okay. Thank you all. Petition number 1860, New Legislation for Prescription and Limitation Act, which is a further continued petition lodged by Jennifer Morrison-Holdham. And the petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to amend the Prescription and Limitation Act to allow retrospective claims to be made. And when the committee last considered this petition, It decided to write to the Scottish Government to request an indication of the number of requests courts have received to override the principal limitation time limits and how often courts exercise this discretion. The committee received a response from the Minister for Community Safety, who states that while Section 19A of the Prescription and Limitation Scotland Act 1973 allows the court's discretion to override the principal limitation time limits, the Scottish Government does not collect information about when this discretion is used. The Scottish Courts and Tribunal Service has also confirmed to the Minister that this information is held in a court interlocutor and therefore the SCTS is unable to interrogate this information. The Minister ends her submission by stating the majority of the types of civil cases relevant to this petition are likely to be initiated within the three-year time limit. Under these circumstances, it will only be a few cases that a court will ever have to consider whether its use is equitable discretion to disapply a time limit. Can I kick off by saying this just sounds like an awful lot of nonsense to me. I mean, we specifically were being told that there was an assurance that there was an appeals process. We wrote to find out whether in practice that was a false curtain of comfort, and in so doing to understand had it been exercised and what the outcome of anybody trying to exercise it had been, and we're essentially being told that no records exist of whether requests have been made or what the outcome of any of those requests would be. And I mean, I don't know if I'm alone in all of this, but I mean, I'm afraid I'm left very much with the impression that this is like meeting the men from the ministry. The petitioner and others are being told that there is an appeals process, but there's absolutely nothing to really indicate whether this appeals process is a reality or a chimera. But that's my kind of tuppence worth to say. Anybody else want to come in? Alexander Stewart.
I'd agree, Convener. You've given a very good synopsis of where we are. As I say, that there is, without question, there is no real ability here for these individuals to see what is the case. We're being told one thing, but the practice is something completely different. So I have some real anxiety about this.
Anyone else? I mean, David Torrens?
Convener, I find it incredible that there's no information out here to see how many times it's been used, especially in the court system. So I'd be quite happy to write to the Scottish Government again and say, how are you going to fill this gap in and provide evidence of it?
Well, I mean, on that basis, can we write then to the Scottish Government expressing our concern that, in fact, you know, what is meant to be a recourse for the public isn't something that we have any data to quantify whatsoever, and really simply telling us that there is no way to quantify the data at the present time seems to fall short of really, I think, the adequate security that is intended by the process being there in the first place and what the government's attitude to that is. Thank you. Petition number 1865, suspend all surgical mesh and fixation devices, submitted to us by Rosanna Clark and Lauren McDougall and Graham Robertson. And again, colleagues will recall that we took extensive evidence from this just prior to recess. It calls on the Scottish Government to suspend the use of all surgical mesh and fixation devices while a review of all surgical procedures which use polyester, polypropylene and titanium is carried out, and guidelines for the surgical use of mesh are established. And we did take that evidence from Marie Todd, the Minister for Public Health, Women's Health and Sport, from David Bishop, the mesh team leader, and Terry O'Kelly, a senior medical advisor at the Scottish Government. And we agreed to consider the evidence at this subsequent meeting. Our recollection, I'm sure, is that the evidence session highlighted a number of key themes, and those included the work of the Scottish Health Technologies Group on mesh and alternative treatments, such as natural tissue repair, the importance of informed consent for patients undergoing mesh treatments, which the Minister accepted, as I recall, was something on which more work needed to be done because a similar experience was being reported to that which women who had received the informed consent allegedly in relation to transvaginal mesh had identified in pursuit of the parallel petition on mesh, which we closed at the last meeting, and future data collection using a unique device identifier such as a barcode in all implanted devices to track the device and patient progress. Now, a summary of the evidence is provided for members with this week's papers. We've also received a response from the petitioner following the evidence session, which has also been circulated. And I just wonder if colleagues would like to discuss where we are at in their mind following that session. David Torrance.
Thank you, Convener. I would like to keep the petition open and write to the Minister for Public Health, Women's Health and Sport to ask an update on the outcome of a Medicines and Healthcare Products Regulatory Agency report. I think it's important that we know about that before we can make a decision about anything.
Alexander Stewart.
Yes, Convener, I would concur with that. I think we got the themes from the Minister and we got some of the areas of data collection that require to be looked at, but it would be useful to just continue that process to ensure that, that with regard to the operation of things and how things are progressing, that we get that full information so that we can have a measured approach to it, because I think there's a huge amount of work being done on this already and it's very topical for many people and it still has raised some concerns about the way the whole thing is managed. So I think I would want to have it continued so that we can seek more evidence and we can continue to progress on behalf of the organisations and the individuals who are having to go through this procedure.
Anyone else? Bill Kidd.
Thank you, Convener. This is of the moment, sadly, and has been for quite some time. And I think it's very important that this committee does continue its pursuits, maybe a very strong word, but it's work to ensure that we do keep this in the public domain and we do keep the Scottish Government's eyes fixed firmly on it until we can get this resolved, actually.
Thank you. Paul Sweeney?
Yeah, thank you, Convener. I think one of the interesting aspects of the evidence that was raised was alternative treatments, and there was sort of indications that there were alternative innovations happening in places like Canada. There was a mention of the Shoulders Hospital, so I think actually us formally engaging with that institution would be helpful to indicate what they might regard as an appropriate way of tackling this as an alternative form of treatment. I think there was less certainty about what was going to happen in Scotland with regards to those alternative treatments, so firming up an understanding of what that can offer would be really helpful.
Yeah, no, I agree. I mean, for my own part, I felt that the evidence session identified a distinction between this petition and the use of polypropylene mesh in the transvaginal procedures, which is the subject of a stay by the Scottish Government at the present time. And I don't know that the ultimate aim of this petition, which is an outright ban on all mesh procedures whatsoever, was necessarily validated by the evidence I heard. But what came out of that evidence was a series of other issues, which I think colleagues have explored, have identified, which we should continue to explore in relation to informed consent, in relation to alternative tissue options, and just more generally in terms of the materials that are being used and the reviews that are taking place into all of that. So I think this is an occasion where I think there's real merit in maintaining the petition, exploring the options that colleagues have identified, but to recognise that we're doing all of that as a consequence of the evidence session without necessarily expecting that that will lead to, you know, the outcome the petitioner was seeking in the first instance, which was a ban on all procedures. Does that seem a reasonable kind of assessment? So thank you for all those suggestions, and I think we will keep the petition open and proceed on that basis. The next petition is the last of our continuing petitions this morning. Petition number 1886 to establish a specialist paediatric liver centre in Scotland, submitted by Ryan Gowran. The petition calls on Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to establish a specialist paediatric liver centre in Scotland. And when we last considered this, the committee agreed to write the Scottish Government, not so much in relation to pursuing that option, but to highlight the petitioner's concerns and to ask what financial support could be made available to families travelling to support family members being treated far from home. And I think we kind of identified that there was quite a strong upfront cost, which was not necessarily equitably bearable by a number of families, depending on, you know, how much and how often they had to incur that cost before they were able to receive any reimbursement. So in its submission, the Scottish Government states there is already guidance available to NHS boards on the reimbursement of patient travel costs. Furthermore, individual boards are responsible for developing and applying their own policies and must ensure equity of access, consider local circumstances, and ensure that schemes are patient-centred. The submission highlights that where a patient is eligible for assistance with travel costs, claims will be settled within 1 to 2 weeks. Health boards can also make bookings on behalf of eligible patients, and where there's a need for travel, to assist them in identifying and accessing available assistance. The Scottish Government states that it plans to take forward, importantly, I think, a comprehensive review of these arrangements. And so I think we've got quite a comprehensive response to the issue that we were pursuing in that respect. Bill Kidd?
Yes, indeed, and I don't know that we can actually achieve much more than possibly writing to the Scottish Government just to ask where we stand with aid to those families who require this money. I mean, I know that it was it has been talked about and that it's been worked on. Where are we just now, though, is something I think is very important for a lot of families.
Yep. So would you like to keep the petition open or close it with that action in place?
I think close it with that action in place, I think. I mean, I don't know that we can do any more except that. So, but I think we should actually at least take that step.
Happy to do that. David Charnes?
I'd agree with closing the petition under Rule 15.7 of Standing Orders, but I'd also ask that the Scottish Government engage with the petitioner to see the difficulties they've had at claiming expenses back and share their experiences so we could feed into that review.
That's fine. Bill, could just so I'm clear, what in relation to the current position do we want the Scottish Government to articulate further?
Sorry, I'll just go back slightly and what my colleague David Torrance has said and establish how, you know, the Scottish Government to speak directly to the petitioner and find where these problems actually are in order to address these.
All right, okay. Yeah, that makes sense. I think we can try and facilitate that because, I mean, clearly there is an expectation that this should be happening, yet the petitioner feels that their own experience and possibly the experience of others is not quite met that. Okay, thank you very much. Item two in our agenda this morning is the consideration of new petitions. And the first of these is... And again, just for the for those who are watching and for the petitioners themselves who might be following these proceedings, to say that before we consider these petitions for the first time orally here in committee, we have sought the views of the Scottish Government, and in some instances other submissions have also been received, which allow us to have an informed discussion ahead of the consideration of the petition. Petition 1900, then, is access to prescribed medication for detainees in police custody. And it's been lodged by Kevin John Lawson. And the petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to ensure that all detainees in police custody can access their prescribed medication, including methadone, in line with existing relevant operational procedures and guidance. The Scottish Government submission confirms strongly that it considers that fast and appropriate access to treatment, including all forms of opiate substitution, is important. The submission highlights its new national mission to reduce drug deaths and harms and the medication-assisted treatment standards, which ministers are committed to embed by April 22. The Scottish Government confirms that it has sought assurances from the Scottish Health and Custody Networks that opioid substitution therapy is being provided to people in custody across Scotland. And the Scottish Government goes on to state that once the medical-assisted treatment standards are fully embedded, the Scottish Government will monitor this provision within the NHS Grampian area. In his submission, the petitioner suggests that there is a contradiction between what the official guidance states must happen to detainees in custody regarding prescribed medication and what is actually happening. And he asks that an inquiry is launched to look into the death in custody of detainees who, in the petitioner's opinion, were medically triaged by unqualified police staff. Comments, colleagues? I certainly read this gentleman's petition with a great deal of concern, but I then read the Scottish Government's submission, which was a very strong response seeking to offer assurance that the practice in place is to the contrary. The weakness for me in the Scottish Government's response was that no register is kept which can substantiate the fact, so that we don't actually know how many requests for prescribed medications have been received, or have confirmation that those requests, or how those requests were dealt with. And while I'm reassured by the Scottish Government's commitment to stating that this should be the case, I'm slightly unnerved by the fact that we are unable to demonstrate that this is the case. And I do wonder whether the absence of any formal record of requests received or prescriptions prescribed is entirely as it should be. But I mean, that was just a thought in my own mind. Any other colleagues have a view? Alexander Stewart.
I think you hit a nail on the head, Convener, when you talk about the duty of care, because there is a duty of care for these individuals when they are in the situation they find themselves, and ensuring that there is, having no data to show us that, is a concern, because you would assume and you would imagine that in that situation, individuals who required that support would receive it. But if we don't have anything to prove that's the case, then there is the dubiety amongst the process. So with regard to that, I do think there is more clarity required as to what they intend to put in place if something isn't in place already.
Paul Sweeney?
Yes, Convener, I share concerns that the processes of monitoring aren't sufficiently mature to, you know, one hand you have the government submission, which might be sincerely held, but if they aren't actually connected to what's going on in a custody suite in a location in Scotland at any particular time, then how would they know any different? So I think that this has definitely highlighted a blind spot in their current monitoring procedures in Scotland, and I think it's well worth further investigation.
And that's without casting any aspersions on anybody. I mean, we the point is we simply can't substantiate, and nobody can substantiate the point. Any other colleague want to come in? So I think we are minded then to keep this petition open and to write to the Scottish Government further on this whole question of monitoring, I think is the key issue arising from all of this. And in the absence of that, how they can be certain or assured that we have got the provisions in place required. Paul Sweeney, are you seeking to come back in?
Whether it might be worth seeking submissions from relevant charities operating in the drug treatment environment, perhaps Transform, for example. I'm sure the clerks can perhaps come up with a potential list.
A suitable shortlist.
That might be worth just inviting responses from.
Yeah, which might get us some further evidence one way or the other of what people think is actually happening.
Yeah.
Yep, thank you for that. Good suggestion. We're content? Yes. Thank you all. Petition 1901, replace the voting system for the Scottish Parliament with a more proportional alternative, which has been submitted by Richard Wood, who is inviting us to consider this issue in a different perspective of yet again, always one that is open to discussion. The petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to replace the broadly proportional additional member system used for electing MSPs with a more proportional alternative. The Spice briefing sets out two examples of proportional voting systems. Single transferable vote, STV, uses multiple member electoral districts or regions, with each voter ranking preferred candidates in a single ballot. Scottish local elections take place by STV, for example. And open list proportional representation, the open list PR, variant of the party list proportional representation, where voters have influence over the preference order of party candidates. The briefing notes that there are concerns over the list order effect with STV. This is described as a concern that candidates near the top of the list in the ballot paper are more likely to be selected. And the Scottish Government submission advises that it does not currently have any plans to propose changes to the voting system by which MSPs are elected to the Scottish Parliament. Colleagues, David Turns.
I don't know if there's any appetite to change a voting system from any political parties or the government, but I think we should write to key stakeholders to seek their views on what a petitioner's asking for, and that's Electoral Reform Society Scotland and the Electoral Commission.
Okay, I think we're content to do that. I mean, but the Scottish Government's position is quite clear, but I think it would be useful for us just to have a current litmus test of the views of these other organisations in current circumstance. Paul Sweeney?
You know, I'm sympathetic because I think certainly it's something that's perhaps an ongoing, worthwhile discussion to have. There was a Scottish Constitutional Convention in the 1990s, which of course established that the additional member system was the preferred electoral system, but perhaps there is an ongoing need to consider alternatives. Obviously, there was the introduction of the single transferable vote in the mid-2000s for local government elections. I think there have been some observations of concerning practices in the most recent Scottish Parliament elections, most notably the the Greens perhaps were stymied in some instances by a sort of decoy Green Party, which was higher up the list, which seduced votes away from them. That was certainly something I noticed in Glasgow at the count. So there are clearly flaws with the current list structure and the two ballots that are worth further investigation.
Indeed. I'm sure my own party's been subject to that discretion as well, but we prevailed. Bill Kidd.
Thank you very much. No, I do, very strongly, I do remember what Paul Sweeney was talking about there, and in order to avoid the mild embarrassment that might take place when Alistair Aardvark gets elected in front of the rest of us, I think we should be looking at this. Thank you.
Splendid. Well, the capacity of politicians for a bit of political self-flagellation never dims, so we will ask the various electoral authorities for their views on how we might suitably be re-elected under different methods, and come back to this. Notwithstanding the Scottish Government's lack of appetite, we will take the matter forward and consider it afresh. So we'll keep petition open on that basis. Petition number 1902 to allow an appeal process for community participation requests. And apologies, it's quite a long note. And we have been, as if to prove my earlier point, we are joined again by Rhoda Grant, who wasn't expecting necessarily to be with us this morning. So I'm pleased that you are, because it means I now don't have to read out what was going to be your written submission as an alternative. This has been submitted to us by Maria Aiken on behalf of Caithness Health Action Team, and it calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to allow an appeal process for community participation requests under the Community Empowerment Act 2015. This Act was intended to encourage and support community involvement and participation in public services. Part 3 of the Act introduces the right for participation requests, which aim to ensure engagement and dialogue between community participation bodies. The right to appeal decisions on participation requests was examined by the previous Local Government and Communities Committee during its post-legislative scrutiny of the 2015 Act, and a recommendation was made in the committee's final report relating to an appeals process. A 3-year evaluation on the operation of participation requests was published in April 2020 and concluded that given the significant challenges in introducing an appeals process and ensuring its fairness and robustness, alongside the very small numbers of participation requests completed using the legislation, this would likely be a longer-term piece of work. The Scottish Government submission notes that the Scottish Community Development Centre has been asked to explore what an appeals process might look like, and the centre will report its findings later this year. And I'm delighted to ask Rhoda Grant to speak in support of this petition.
Thank you, Convener, and thank you for allowing me in again. I meet with the chat quite regularly, and in July this year they raised this issue with me about community participation. They had contacted NHS Highland, and NHS Highland had refused to recognise them as a constituted community control body. I believe that the group is controlled by the community and do need to be recognised as such. CHAT have a constitution, and that includes provision that they are community-led. They hold regular AGMs and have regular meetings with the community that they represent. I then took this up with NHS Highland on the group's behalf, but they have not changed their position on this. There is no appeals process, so no chance for chat to debate its case with someone from out with the organisation. Members of the public regularly contact chat, asking for their assistance and advising them of issues that they have faced. And that often puts them at odds with NHS Highland, if I'm being honest. But I believe they're fulfilling an important role in their community. Chat are keen to have the Health Authority engage with its members before action is taken up in Caithness. And chat has given me some examples of where there has been no consultation at all. For instance, the introduction of a midwife-led maternity unit, which resulted in a 200-mile round trip to Raigmore Hospital for at-risk women who are pregnant. I agree that people in Caithness are victims of centralisation of healthcare services, and rural areas are being left out of the decision-making process. An appeals process would let the group in question the ruling of any public body, and I support that its introduction sooner rather than later. But I would also suggest that I think NHS Highland dismissing this appeal out of hand is wrong as well. And I think that an appeal process would at least give them the right to call that into question, but I think it's questionable.
Thank you very much for that, Rhoda Grant. Any comments from colleagues? David Torrens.
Thank you, Convener. I think we should keep the petition open and write to Scottish Community Development Centre seeking an update on its work, exploring an appeal process for a community participation request, and to ask when it expects this work to be concluded.
I mean, it's certainly my experience, and I don't mean to generalise, but it has been my experience with health boards, particularly where no appeals process to a process exists, that you can get a determination and meet a blank wall of in pursuit of any alternative. And it does seem to me that the absence of an appeals process here is a failing, because it's quite a subjective view. Obviously, the case you've expressed an interest on behalf of simply being excluded, and that seems to be that. And yet that is the body that local people, as you're representing it, are using to try and make those representations. Alexander Stewart.
Thank you, Kenina. No, there's no doubt there's a gap here. You know, the whole talk about engagement and dialogue involved in the in community participation. And I think Rhoda Grant has put together quite a strong case this morning about where what's happening in specifics. So I do think that we need to continue with this to get more clarity, to understand what the procedures are and how it can be assessed, and how we can actually ensure that what should be taking place or might be taking place with Across This Health Board is taking place.
And I suppose a recurring theme of this morning's meeting is that we should ensure that requests for appeals are recorded and the outcomes monitored, since that was an issue in one of our earlier petitions. So we will keep the petition open. Thank you very much, Rhoda Grant. And we will, I think, in the first instance, seek to get some idea of, you know, what the timeline is for this developing appeals process, because we wouldn't want that just to be open-ended, I think, is the point. So thank you very much. And that brings us to our final new petition this morning, which is to review the impact of vaccine passport regulations, which has been tabled, petition number 1908, by Jeff Bell. And the petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to regularly review the impact of vaccine passport regulations following their implementation, and to provide data on how they are used and any benefits that they bring. The committee received a late submission from the Scottish Government regarding this petition, and the Scottish Government's submission highlights the objectives of the scheme, which are to reduce the risk of transmission of coronavirus, to reduce the risk of serious illness and death, thereby alleviating current and future pressure on the National Health Service, to allow higher risk settings to continue, to operate as an alternative to closure or more restrictive measures, and to increase vaccine uptake. The submission explains the requirement for Scottish ministers to review the regulations every 21 days is written into the legislation, and that the regulations should only remain in place while they are necessary and proportionate. Ministers look at a range of data to determine whether the regulations continue to be required. The Scottish Government confirms its commitment to monitoring the impact of certification and is collecting data in order to fully understand the effects of the scheme and how it is being implemented. I think it's worth this committee noting that the Scottish Parliament's COVID-19 Recovery Committee regularly scrutinises the Scottish Government response to the COVID-19 pandemic, including in relation to vaccine passport regulations. This committee is also conducting a short inquiry which requires reviewing the use of the scheme. And in the light of that, I wonder what comments colleagues have. David Torrens.
Considering that the government have to review every 21 days, the First Minister updates us every week in Parliament, and the COVID-19 Recovery Committee takes evidence from ministers every 2 weeks, and they are doing an inquiry into passport vaccines, I think we could close the petition under Rule 15.7 of Standing Orders.
Colleagues, I'm minded to agree. I think on this occasion, yes, I'm supportive of that proposal, particularly in the light of the COVID-19 Recovery Committee's inquiry into the proposal. I think maybe we could let that committee know that we'd received this petition and that we did close it, but that the petitioner had highlighted the particular screen, only for them to note, we've advised them that we did close the petition. Colleagues, that's the last of our formal business this morning, so thank you all very much.